Köszönöm szépen! Jó estét kívánok! Szeretettel köszöntünk mindenkit itt a Robert Kapa Voltás Fotográfiai Központban. Az esemény, vagyis hát az ok, ami miatt itt valójában összejöttünk, az a 38. Magyar Sajtófotó Pályázat zsűrizése, amelyik itt folyik ebben a házban ma reggel óta. You understand or shall I?
Understand.
És ha már zsűrizés, akkor engedjétek meg, hogy bemutassam az idei zsűrit, amelyiknek az elnöke nagyon nagy örömünkre, és mondhatjuk most már szinte hagyományosan, szóval Koményi Tamás, akit nem látok ugyan, de jó, ott ül leghátul. Megszólja az elnöke, most nem is látszik. A másik magyar zsűrita, Stiller Ákos. És most már ez egy jó 10-15 éves hagyomány, hogy külföldi zsűritagokat is meghívunk a zsűriben. És az idei zsűri egyik nem magyar tagja, Daniela Brászkova. A másik külföldi zsűritagunk nagy örömünkre Ron David. És a mellettem ülő úriember pedig Zala Szilva. Most elmondom, mert végre megtanultam, actually is João Paulo da Costa Silva. De a rövidített név, amit használ, az João Silva. Gondolom, hogy az ő munkásságával is sokat találkoztatok. Ugye őt nagyon sokszor emlegetik a Vancouver Club-val kapcsolatosan, amelyik egy érdekes, soha nem létezett csoportosulás volt a Dél-Afrikai Köztársaságban, de valahogy én is rájövődött ez a plusz. És azután ez a Vancouver Club azt csinálta, hogy a Béli fotográfákkal követte a változásokat az apartheid rezsim megszűnése kezdetétől, illetve azt közvetlenül megelőző időszakból, és azután pedig a Zsuhavó háborús fényképészként, war and conflict photographerként lett azt hiszem világhírű. Van egy másik része is a dolognak, ami nem ezért szeretjük, persze nem is mondom el, aki érdekel, azt keresem meg, szerint Zsuhavó, member of Bandan Club, what is actually, as I know, never existed. So that was never a real formation called Bandan Club. It was the press to give you this name, but it was a band of photographers who followed the changes in South Africa Republic after the liberation of Nelson Mandela, or actually from the time, and then he became a world famous war conflict photographer. És akkor most nagyon nagy örömünkre megkérem Zsuhavót, hogy az első ilyen a ma esti első körben prezentációt ő tartsa meg. Zsuhavó, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being here. I just want to start off by saying thank you for coming, and that it's a great privilege and an honor to be in your country. It's my first time in Hungary, so I'm very happy to be here, and very happy to see the amazing work that is done by the Hungarian photographers. I'm going to be showing some pictures in the background. My career has spanned 30 years, but I'm not going to be showing you every single conflict. I'm not going to be showing every single country that I've been to. The pictures that are going to be basically slide-showing in the background while I speak are the three countries that had the biggest impact on me, on my psyche, on my soul, and on my physical being. And those countries are South Africa, Iraq, and Afghanistan. Later on, if there's questions about the pictures, we can gladly talk about them. But basically, I'm going to talk about my path through my career, which brought me to where I am today. So in order to talk about my story and what took me to war photography, I have to start at the beginning. I was born in Portugal, Lisbon, come from a very poor background. And in the 60s, under the dictatorship, for a poor person in Portugal to be able to further himself beyond poverty, you were forced to immigrate to the colonies, which is exactly what my parents did. They immigrated to Mozambique. Unfortunately, my dad, not being well educated, he completely misread the political signs. And we lived in Mozambique for a very brief period before the revolution happened, before the dictator was deposed, and the colonies were abandoned. And of course, with the abandonment of the colonies came independence and then the impending civil war. So when this political upheaval first started, my parents decided that they would not return to Portugal. What they were going to do is they were going to stay in Africa and go to South Africa, because at the time, South Africa, the apartheid government was inviting a lot of the expats that were fleeing the colonies during this global political change in order to elevate, in order to increase the white population. So all these immigrants from Angola, Rhodesia, which is now Zimbabwe, Mozambique, they helped bring up the white population, of course, but they also brought skills. So my parents decided that they would follow this path, but because they did not have the money to do it in one single fell sweep, and because the civil war was coming, they decided to ship me off to Portugal to go live with relatives where I would be safe, and then they sold everything that they had in order to make their way across to South Africa. For example, my youngest memories of Mozambique is sleeping fully dressed in case you had to evacuate in the middle of the night. And distant gunfire in the distance. There was no fighting in the streets at that point. So there was no immediate danger, but it was obvious that things were going to change. And of course, after that, Mozambique had the civil war that endured 19 years. So once they settled, they eventually brought me back to South Africa. So I rejoined my parents almost 16 months later. So when I came to South Africa, I was a stranger in a strange country, but I was also a stranger to my parents because I was 7 years old when this happened, and I rejoined my parents when I was 9 years old. So this had a big traumatic impact on me. And arriving in South Africa was very weird because you, even though the government wanted to, you know, increase the white population, you as an immigrant were never welcome. South Africa had the pyramid scheme. You had the white Afrikaner, which were right on top. Then you had the English-speaking South African, and then all the immigrants. And at the bottom of the immigrant pile were the Portuguese, and then after that were the people that are called coloreds, and then the black South Africans right at the bottom. So for me growing up in that system, I realized very early on that this summing was not right with the society because I was not welcome. And I was clearly different from the rest of the white people. So again, that had a big impact on my life. Photography came as a surprise. because of the way I grew up, because of the separation, because of being in a country where you felt you didn't belong, I grew up very angry, and I was just a naughty kid. I'm a high school dropout. I grew up, my young adult life was working in nightclubs, getting involved in a lot of fights. That's how I made a living. And then one day, miraculously, I found photography through a friend. A friend of mine was studying graphic design, and one of the subjects that he had to do for graphic design was to photograph motion, to take pictures of motion, to illustrate motion. And we were all petrolheads. We grew up with motorcycles, race cars, all that kind of stuff. And this friend came to the racetrack to photograph the cars and the bikes going around to capture motion. And that's when the bug first caught. When he suggested of coming, I was like, do you mind if I take a few pictures? And he was like, sure, you know, buy your own film. This is still, I mean, this was 30 years ago, so this is the film era. And he says, okay, you know, once I've done my pictures, you can shoot. And that was the first time I touched the camera, because we had no camera in the family. Like I said, it was a poor background. My parents didn't have money for cameras. But it was like a light switch had been turned on. I knew immediately what I was going to do with my life. And I didn't qualify for formal studies because I had not finished my high school. So basically, I started educating myself by reading as much literature as I could on photography, and immediately started taking pictures. And funny enough, within a couple of months of taking my first picture, I was already being published. And the other interesting thing was that I knew from the onset what I wanted to do. It was very clear in my mind. I was not going to do fashion photography. I was not going to do wildlife photography. I was going to become a war photographer. And, you know, over time, it became very clear why I was doing it. I mean, people become war photographers for many reasons. They want to crusade against a bad cause. They want to be the voice of those that don't have a voice. They want to, it can be a rite of passage because, you know, you want to experience war. In my case, it was more of me experiencing the external forces that had such a big impact in my own life. I would have been a very different child had I not been separated from my parents in a very crucial period in my life because of social political happenings, historical events, the end of the colonial system. So there I was, a camera, going forward and trying to explore those external forces. And soon after I picked up a camera, the political climate changed in South Africa. Nelson Mandela was released. And with the release of Nelson Mandela and the political parties, which till that point had been banned, it also was the beginning of the political violence that lasted 4 years. It started in 1990 and it ended in 1994. Now, essentially, the political violence that happened was a proxy war that was created by the white government, which pitted one dominant tribe, which is the Zulus, which all supported one political party called the Inkatha Freedom Party, against the rest of the population. And the reason for doing this was to destabilize the democratic process that was coming. Now, up until that point, there used to be something that used to be called the state of emergency. So journalists could not go into the townships. Everything was controlled. The minute Nelson Mandela was released and the political parties were unbanned, that law was abolished. And then suddenly, photographers were free to do the work that they wanted to do. And so basically, the political violence coincided with the beginning of my career. And it was a very violent time. It's important to know that in those 4 years, 20,000 civilians were killed in a situation where there was no artillery, there was no tanks, there was no aerial bombardment. It was all up close and personal. You got to see the eyes of the person who was going to kill you. And we as photographers got caught up in that vortex. So we got to witness some really brutal killings. And yeah, it was an education of sorts, but it was also an emotionally complicated place to be at, because you've got this, you know, low-intensity civil war that is happening in your adoptive country. It is, South Africa is my country. I was born in Portugal, but South Africa is my country. And you got to see some very brutal things. You got to see friends get killed. And at the same time, you were part of it, but you were not part of it. There was, people always say to me, it must have been very complicated for you to cover a war in your own country. It must be very different to covering a war in, say, a foreign country. And yes and no. And the reason why I say this is, yes, it was happening in our country, and it affects the future of everybody. But white South Africans were not directly influenced by the war. I lived in a white neighborhood. The violence that was happening in black communities. So I'd go in at dawn before the lights up with my friends and colleagues and all the other journalists. I wasn't the only journalist doing it. And then at the end of the day, or when we had enough, we'd go back to our safety neighborhoods, the bubble, the white bubble that was South Africa, and then we'd be safe. And then in the morning, next morning, we'd go back into the war zone. So it was very discombobulating. It was emotionally, it was difficult to say you were part of it when you're actually just documenting it, even though you're South African, if this makes any sense. So this also coincided with the time that came to be known as the Bang Bang Club. Again, it's very important to know that the Bang Bang Club never existed. There was no such thing. We were a group of friends, and sometimes friends from abroad joined us. Ronnie's one of them. And, you know, we all just happened to do the same work. There was a magazine, a current news slash, I don't know, general kind of thing. And the editor wrote an article about these photographers that were covering the conflict, and he called it, the title was The Bang Bang Paparazzi. That was the initial article of that included us. And we were very upset about that. We were, you know, this is very serious. People are dying, you know, and to make light of it is just not on. And fast forward a couple of years, that same editor wrote another article, and then he called it the Bang Bang Club. And it stuck. And so we've now become known as the Bang Bang Club. But there was no such thing as a club. You know, we just happened to be friends that did the same kind of work. And very seldom were we ever in the same place at the same time. So a lot of it is fiction. And if anybody who's actually read the book, we make that very clear in the book. In fact, this is not common knowledge, but the title of the book was not the Bang Bang Club. When we wrote the book, the title was The Dead Zone. Now, the dead zones were the neighborhoods around the hostels. The hostels are barrack-type complexes for migrant workers, which is where the Zulus from a different province used to live. And from there, they used to fan out and attack the communities around them. Those immediate communities became abandoned. They wrecked out neighborhoods. People had to flee. Those that did not flee were killed. So those areas became known as the dead zone. And that's where the fighting between the community and the Inkatha Freedom Party warriors took place. And but of course, once it came time for publication, there was no choice but to go with the Bang Bang Club, because that was the selling point and that was what people had associated us with. And to make matters worse, there's been a movie made, which is a very crap movie, which only reinforces the stereotypes of this Bang Bang Club bullshit. But there was no club. At the end of the day, we were just committed professionals who were prepared to die for what we believed in, to show the reality of what was happening in the country. And we lost friends. We lost two to combat, and we lost two to suicide. You know, it's part of it. You know, we, as you see in some of the pictures, there's some heavy brutality, and you were forced to witness it. Sometimes you could help, sometimes you couldn't help. And you know, in the instance where this young man was killed and hacked to death in front of me, while I was photographing, there's a whole sequence of from beginning to end. I've only ever published two pictures out of the whole sequence, which is the moment they're telling him they're going to kill him, and then when they kill him. But it was very brutal. They drove over him with a car. They hacked him. They dropped rocks on his head. They shot him. They set him on fire. And while all that was going on, I'm taking pictures. I am screaming. Inside, I'm screaming because, you know, I don't know where I belong. I know what I'm doing is not natural, but it's got to be done because it's important to document what's happening. But your human self, that core, wants to help, but you can't. So to this day, it's one of those moments that I feel I failed as a human being, not having intervened. But having said that, a few minutes after the last picture that I took, we had to run for our lives. I was with two photographers photographing this moment. We had to run for our lives. And so that tells me that had I tried to intervene, I would have been killed, perhaps. So maybe on the day that was the right choice to do. But you will always live with these things. And collectively as journalists, whether it's combat or whether it's, you know, human drama or social change, the reality of what we do is that, you know, everything that goes through the lens is forever burnt into your mind. You know, the camera is not a filter and the lens is not a shield. So you will forever live with, you know, daylight nightmares, if that's a way to, because very seldom do these things go away. You know, I'm not saying this, I mean, I'm not traumatized, I'm not, you know, I think to a certain extent we all suffer from a certain amount of PTSD. It's all moral injury, as it's more commonly referred to now, because it's inevitable. We see the best in the world. You see the best of humanity and the worst of humanity. You can see both in the same day. In Somalia, the one day, for example, I'm photographing this mother. The child has just died in her hand. She's swaying. She doesn't want to let go of the child. The picture is all these hands coming into the frame trying to pull the child away from her, and she won't let go. And it was a very emotional scene, and I was in tears. And then later on that day, we move on to a different part of north of Mogadishu, a place called Baidoa. And there in a queue of people waiting to receive food, this was, you know, during a period of no fighting. This was 92. A young lady gave birth to twins in the queue while waiting for food. So in the same day, I saw life and death. And those things will live with you forever, you know. So, you know, after South Africa, okay, while I was covering South Africa, I was already traveling to Sudan, Somalia, Angola. My first trip to Afghanistan was in the 90s. I was already starting to establish my career as a photojournalist. And I guess the next big chapter in my life would have to be Iraq. I documented Iraq from 2003 until 2010. I would do, on average, I would kind of rotate between Iraq and Afghanistan. But the first few years of the Iraq war, Iraq became the priority. People kind of forgot about Afghanistan. And then around 2006, people started paying attention again to Afghanistan. Iraq was quite something. I don't think I'd ever seen as much mayhem, as much death in one single space as I saw in Iraq. There'd be days, there'd be 20 car bombs in Baghdad. You'd be running from one car bomb to the next. And that went on for years. And then, of course, you're also covering the combat. You're embedding either with one side or the other. I spent a lot of time with American soldiers, but also spent a lot of time with the Iraqi insurgents, with the Shia insurgents, which are known as the Mahdi Army. And yeah, it was an incredibly interesting time and a really sad time because I don't think Iraq deserved the hell that descended upon them, and certainly Iraqi civilians didn't. And at the time that I left in 2010, over 250,000 civilians had been killed. So that's an astronomical figure. Yeah, like I say, Iraq, Afghanistan, bounce back and forth. And when I first went to Iraq, to Afghanistan in 1994, it was during the civil war, right after the Soviets had pulled out. And the fighting was all in the city. The city was divided by different warlords. And I immediately fell in love with the place. It was beyond visual. It was beyond comprehension. And I went back periodically. And ultimately, that's where my career would end as a war photographer. In Iraq in 2010, it was a quiet moment. There was nothing particularly exciting going on. I was with a task force of the 4th Infantry Division, and we're in a place south of Kandahar called Ogundob Valley, which has often been referred to as the birthplace of the Taliban. And our mission there was to do a story on the great gains that the U.S. Army had made in clearing the province, in clearing that particular valley, the Ogundob Valley, which up until then was the most mined in terms of landmines and also in terms of improvised explosive devices in the country. And the Americans had lost a lot of troops, and there'd been a lot of fighting in that area, and there had been gains, there'd be successes. So the story was to document that. And we were in an area where every single patrol, all movement was dismounted. There was no room for vehicles. You got dropped off in a helicopter, and then you joined one of the units, and you lived in a combat outpost, which is basically a house in a village that is occupied by the military, and it is fortified in the sense that they put sandbags and all that kind of stuff. And from there, a contingency of U.S. soldiers and Afghan soldiers together will go out on their missions to the different areas. And on that particular day, I was moving with the unit. We were going from one base to the next base. There was nothing going on. There was no fighting going on. But it's dangerous. So you move in defensive formation, and you basically have a soldier up front with a dog. And the dog is smelling for different explosives, for any device that might be buried in the ground. And that's how you move. We less, maybe half a kilometer from where the base was, we'd reach a location where the previous day we had found an explosive device and we had destroyed it in place. So basically, the dog had detected something, and they called in the ordnance experts, the guys who destroy the munitions, and in place, they destroyed it. Not very exciting pictures, big explosion, boom, whatever, but it's part of what you have to do in order to move forward. So the next day, when we reached that very location, everybody got very, very, very nervous because of what happened the day before. So the rest of the unit stayed back, all in defensive positions, but we were not being shot at. There was no shooting. It was very calm. And myself, the guy up front with the dog, And another soldier between us kept moving forward to make sure that the way is clear going forward. And in these kind of situations, you follow each other's footsteps. So I will stay as far as I am from you, from the next person, and the next guy stays at that distance from the guy up front with the dog. So we kept moving. Nothing was found. We got to a location where there was a compound, a partially destroyed compound, completely abandoned. And they decided, the guy with the dog, decided that he would go investigate that compound area for any explosive devices. When we got to the entrance of the compound, I decided to wait, because part of the way that these explosive devices are placed are often at the entrance to compounds or at the entrance to buildings. So as the soldiers go through, it explodes. So I decided, you know what, I'm going to wait. Let them go. And then once they get inside and I see it safe, then I will follow. And that's exactly what I did. The guy with the dog went through. The guy providing security, when I say he's providing security, basically the guy with the dog is looking down. So he does not have eyes on his environment. He can't see. So the guy providing security for him is the guy who's basically watching his back. So the two went through. I waited until they got to the location where I thought immediate danger was. Once they got there, nothing happened. I then decided, okay, it's safe to join them. And as I took that first step, boom. So, you know, who knows? I'd follow the same path they walked. I wasn't taking my own path. I was following their footsteps. So a millimeter to the left, a millimeter to the right, an inch forward, an inch back, who knows? But I stood on the landmine. And so that was it. I fell face down. I was the only one injured. The soldiers are not injured. I rolled on my back. I called for help. I said, guys, I need help. They all rushed towards me. They picked me up. They dragged me to a safe location, what they call the kill zone. They dragged me out of that zone to a different, and they do this for two reasons, because a lot of the explosive devices are attached to a secondary device. So either it's done so one detonates a bigger one, or it's done for once one has gone off, when the rescuers come to help, the second one goes off, and then you maximize how many soldiers you kill. So they dragged me out of that immediate area for safety in case there was a second device. The minute they put me down, the first thing I did is I took pictures. You know, over time I've been criticized for taking pictures when perhaps I shouldn't, when somebody's been killed in front of me, my closest friend dies at my feet. I took pictures of him. A Marine gets shot by a sniper before he hits the ground. I've already taken the picture before he hits the ground. So when it happened to me, it's the way I'm wired. It's the way that my brain functions. So even though it had happened to me, I needed to try document. I could see my legs were gone. I could see my legs were shredded. But I was trying to document, and I managed to shoot off three frames before I felt intense pain and I dropped the camera. But I still managed three frames. The three frames are there somewhere. It's the soldier coming towards me with the smoke in the background. So that's the way I'm wired. I need to document even if it's happening to me. Then, you know, I dropped the camera. The soldiers descended on me, the medics descended on me. There was two medics with, because where we were, it is so remote that each squad as a medic. And we were two squads. So I immediately had two medics on top of me. And they immediately started applying tourniquets, taking my body armor off, all that crap. While they were doing this, I asked for a cigarette because my cigarettes had been blown off. So I had a smoke because I still had strength to smoke. I had no strength to take pictures, but I could smoke. I was with a correspondent called Carlotta Gol, a very brave lady who's covering Afghanistan for decades. She used to live there, in fact. And she was in the back of the unit. She was the writer on the story. And she came forward to see what was going on. And I asked her for the phone, the sat phone. And then I called home. I called my wife. I guess the reason why I did this is it's a twofold. Firstly, because I wanted her to hear from me that I'd been injured, as opposed for her to hear it from an editor in New York who she does not know. So at least that would be some reassurance. She would hear my voice. So I told her, you know, so that was the first reason. I think the second reason is that if I was going to die, I'd want to speak to her at least one more time. At that point, I don't know how severe my injuries were. I could see my legs were gone, but I had a lot of internal damage. So, you know, I came close to dying a few times, but anyway, that's a different story. And so I spoke to her and I told her that I'd been injured, but I think I was going to live. She was, of course, distraught. I passed the phone back to Carlotta, and then Carlotta stayed on the phone with my wife, talking her through it. You know, the doctor, you know, medics are working on him, the helicopter's arriving, all that kind of stuff, just to keep her reassured. I asked for another cigarette. At that point, the medics said no. And they continued to work on me. And that's pretty much it. Within 12 minutes of me being blown up, the medevac, the dust off, the medevac helicopter landed. And that's it. They loaded my helicopter. So my memory, my recollection of the event is completely crystal clear until they put me in the helicopter. Once I'm in the helicopter, that's when I start losing my memory. But according to the medical records, I was conscious even when I got to Kandahar and speaking to the doctors, I was completely lucid, but I have no recollection of that. So on that day, it's just a case of my number came up, you know. As I mentioned earlier, the camera is not a shield, you know. It's people get injured, people get killed next to you. Why not you? I mean, the only way you're going to be totally safe in this kind of situation is if you don't go into these kind of situations. So when I got injured, I was pragmatic about it. It was just, okay, my turn came up, you know. And, you know, going forward, that really helped with my recovery because my recovery took 3 years and a total of 73 surgeries. It was quite something. So not having that sentiment in your mind of, oh God, why me? That really helped me go through the whole healing process and coming out on the other side okay. And then, you know, just I did get unlucky on that day, if you want to call it, but I also got very lucky because I stepped on a Chinese-made landmine, which is a plastic-type device. But what I did not know at the time is that that device was daisy-chained to a vat. A vat is like a plastic drum that you see in the pictures where some people carry water. A vat with 30 pounds of HME, 30 pounds of homemade explosive. And had that second detonation occurred, I would not be talking in front of you. There would not be enough of me to put in a matchbox. That's how big the explosion would have been. So, unlucky and lucky at the same day. Call it luck, call it bad workmanship, call it the hand of God, whatever, I'll take it. Because at the end of the day, you know, I got to live a little longer, get to see my kids grow up, you know. So So that's it in a nutshell, you know. I came out of hospital in 2013. Ironically, my career started with Mandela being released. The second episode of my career, the second chapter, started with the death of Mandela. When Mandela died, that was the first time that I went back to work. I had not worked for 3 years. I wasn't incapable of doing so. And now I'm back at work full time. Obviously, I don't do the conflict stuff anymore, but I get on a plane once a month. And So that's basically it in a nutshell. That's why I stand here in front of you today. And thank you for listening. Once Ron's done talking, then we'll take the questions, okay? Just to keep the momentum flowing.
Well, it's not easy following Joao, but I'll do my best. Those are just a few of the stories that I've covered in 30 years as a photographer. And often, when I explain to people what I do, how I'm interested in human rights, how I'm trying to raise awareness, trying to have a little bit of impact with my work, and often it involves some danger or being around some danger and so on. And generally, the question is like, why? Why would you do that? What's the point? And especially in today's world, when I explain that I'm a photographer, they're like, do we really need more photographs? I mean, come on. Like, wouldn't you rather just take pictures of your cat or your breakfast? And I have to kind of think about, or I've had to have thought about, what are the reasons that I've done this work and what reasons are specific to me and what approach other people like Joao and other photographers from Seven and so on. And so I'm just going to kind of give you guys a little bit of a mini retrospective of my career and how I came to understanding a little bit about the power and also the limitations of what photography can do and how we are all involved in it together. So I went to university in New York, and generally when you go to university, you're supposed to have an idea of what you want to do for a career, and that's what you study and so on. And all I knew when I went to university was I wanted a job that would make sure that I didn't have to be in an office from 9 to 5 every day. I didn't know what that was, but whatever job that was that would allow me to move around, travel, do whatever, that was the job for me. I had no interest in photography, I had no interest in journalism, but somehow I kind of thought like, oh, you know, maybe I should be a journalist, because they get to travel, they get to do things, without at all understanding what journalism meant. So I started to study journalism, and those of you that don't know, school in America is very, very expensive. So I was working 3 or 4 jobs to help pay for school, and I had loans from banks and so on. And one of the jobs happened to be working for a very famous fashion photographer. And I was brought into the studio, and I was so low on the totem pole that I was the guy that helped the guy that got the coffee. But I started to get a little bit exposed to this world of photography and fashion photography, and it was like, oh, well, this is kind of interesting. Beautiful people, beautiful meals, people that I didn't know traveling first class around the world. Well, that's kind of exciting, cool. And at the same time, I started to get exposed from photography from a good friend of mine who was at university, and then my uncle, who was a very serious hobby photographer, gave me a camera for my birthday. I started playing around with the camera and starting to learn a little bit more about photography. And at some point, and I honestly don't know how I did this, but at some point I said, I should be a photographer. But instead of saying I should be a fashion photographer and have this beautiful, glamorous life, I said, oh, I should be a photojournalist. I shouldn't travel first class. I shouldn't be around beautiful people, and I should eat really badly. Why I made that decision, I still don't know to this day, but that was the decision I made. And basically, I took a basic photo class at school, and I graduated and had to figure out how to be a photographer. And in the United States, if you wanted to be a successful photographer, if you wanted to work for Geographic or Time or Newsweek or the New York Times, you were not supposed to start in New York. You were supposed to go to the Midwest, the middle of the country, like a place like Kansas or Iowa, and you'd work for a small newspaper. And that's where you would get your training. And then eventually, if you're really good, maybe you get to go back to New York, maybe you get to work for some of these magazines, and then maybe you get to travel, and then maybe you get to do some things. But I was like, I'm already in New York. Why would I go to Iowa? I'm staying here. I'm not gonna do that. So I got the names of all the media in New York, because they were all in New York. I wrote out this little script, and I started with the letter A. I called up the Associated Press, the largest wire service in the world. And I said, hey, can I speak to the director of photography? And some guy goes, yeah, sure, let me put you through. And I get bounced around, and some guy picks up the phone and says, yeah, what do you want? And I read my script. My name's Ron Haviv. I just graduated. I'm a photographer. You should hire me, and when should I come in for my interview? And I'm speaking, and the guy is like, there's like dead silence on the end of the line, and then all of a sudden I just hear click, dial tone. Okay, yeah, the guy's in a bad mood. Let me call the next place. I call a tabloid newspaper called the Daily News. This time I'm put on speakerphone. I read my script. And this time I hear a lot of people laughing at me, and then I hear a click and a dial tone. And finally, some small newspaper says, yeah, sure, come on in, we'd be happy to talk to you. And I go in there, and I show the guy what the project I did in class. He spent, I don't know, 45 seconds looking at my prints, black and white prints curling at the edges. I was very excited about them. He was not excited about them at all. And then he turns and says, okay, so why do you want to be a photojournalist? And I'm like, I don't know. I have no idea. And he was, instead of throwing me out of his office, we had a nice conversation about photojournalism. But while we were talking, he kept looking behind me. And finally, I turn around to look at what he's looking at. And he's looking at a mop and a bucket. And he says, I have no interest in working with you as a photographer, but if you know how to use a mop and a bucket, we have a job that pays zero, and you can start working now mopping the floors. And I said, I'll take the job. And I started in what became what's known as being an intern. So I worked as an intern for free for this newspaper, moved up from mopping the floors to, this is a long time ago, like Joao said, it's a film error, developing film, making prints, mixing chemicals, and so on. And then, like probably many of you, there comes this time when you have your first test. And for me, breaking news at the mayor's office in New York City, I was the only photographer there because I was mopping the floor. And he said, okay, we need a photographer, go down and take a picture. The next day, I had my first picture published of a newspaper that probably 25 people saw, but I could tell my parents, look, I know what I'm doing. It's very exciting. And I started to get more and more assignments. And as I started to get more assignments working in New York, I entered this unbelievable world. This world of photojournalism filled with these amazing men and women who were dedicated to this idea of telling a story. And not only that, they were dedicated to this idea of also making sure that the next generation was going to be trained and would be able to also take photographs. So people would put their arm around me and they said, okay, we're gonna go to a demonstration. This is where you stand, this is what's gonna happen. Or let's try and get you some money. I'm gonna introduce you to my editor. So I started working for Agence France Presse and other places and I started to get paid. I started to make a little bit of money. And it was this unbelievable, incredible community that exists to this day, which I'm sure many of you are part of. And one day I was covering this event in New York and I saw this guy walking around. And this guy looked like he was like a movie actor playing a photojournalist. And he had like long blonde hair, press credentials, bunch of cameras, very important photojournalism, scarf. I mean, he had the whole thing. And I went up and I introduced myself. And I said, I am Ron Haviv. And he said, hi, I'm Chris Morrison. And Chris had just come back from the Philippines where he was working for Newsweek magazine. And at that point, I was starting to think about, again, like traveling, getting out, like trying to do something and being as a photojournalist. So I said, Chris, where are you going next? And Chris says, oh, I'm going to Panama. I said, Chris, that's amazing. I'm also going to Panama. I didn't know where Panama was. I didn't know what was happening in Panama. But if this guy's going to Panama, that's the place to go as a photojournalist. And Chris looks at me and goes, yeah, okay, I guess I'll see you there. And we actually lived a couple blocks away from each other. And I ran into him a couple more times. And I had to, now this is, again, a long time ago, so no iPhone to pull out of my pocket to Google what's happening in Panama. So I had to do some research and so on. And Panama, it was a very simple story. Panama was a very important country, not only for the United States, but the world, because of the Panama Canal. And Noriega was kind of going off the rails. He had been supported by the United States or the CIA and so on, and he was kind of playing games, and the United States was getting upset with him. And so Noriega decided to hold elections to prove to the world that he wasn't a dictator. So the story basically was, dictator holds elections. And Noriega, kind of being a character, he also had really bad skin. So his nickname was Pineapple Face. And one of the newspapers I worked for loved Noriega. So whenever he would do something, he'd be on the front page of the paper. So I said to them, can I have an assignment to go cover the election? And they're like, yeah, sure. I was like, cool. I got my first assignment. I ran into Chris. I told him. And then just a few days before I'm about to buy my ticket to go on assignment, the newspaper fires the managing editor, and my assignment is canceled. So I'm walking home, and Chris has his version, I have my version. So I'll be fair, I'll tell you Chris's version. Chris's version is, he sees me walking up the street, I'm crying hysterically, I'm ripping my shirt, there's literally a crowd forming around me, I'm banging on the windows, my life is over, I have no assignment, I can't believe what's happening, and Chris is trying to calm me down and get me away from the people. I mean, it's New York, it's like crazy, right? So Chris is calming me down, so in order to come, once he understood what was happening, he said, look, calm down, he says, I'm on assignment for Time Magazine, and I just bought my plane ticket, and they had a buy one, get one free, like a revolution special. So you can have this extra plane ticket. And since I'm on assignment, there's an extra bed in my room and an extra seat in my car. So faster than I said yes to the mop and the bucket, I said yes to Chris, and this is what happened.
And I just stood there and I took photographs, and still there were bullets flying around and didn't mean anything to me. I was just so intent on taking the photographs. And the photographs were immediately transmitted and were published all over the world. The following week, I had the cover of all three US magazines, Newsweek, Time, and US News. something I think has only been done a few times. The same photographers had all the same covers. It was also my first experience in realizing truly the power of the press. When George Bush announced the invasion of Panama, he used those photographs as a justification for, or one of the justifications for, the actual invasion.
You remember those horrible pictures of newly elected Vice President Ford, covered head to toe with blood, beaten mercilessly by so-called dignity battalions.
So a couple of things happen. First, I'm 23 years old. Nobody's ever heard of me. I got the covers of all these magazines. I'm like, this photojournalism thing's really not that hard. You go places, you take pictures, you get covers. People think you're amazing. You're gonna make money, win lots of prizes. Totally cool. I'm like, oh, this is awesome. I'm so excited. But it wasn't until 7 months later, when the invasion occurred, and I heard the President of the United States speak about the photographs as one of the reasons for the invasion. And of course, they were not the only reason for the invasion, but the fact that the photographs that I took were part of the conversation that was going on, all of a sudden it was like, it's not about me, it's not about covers, of course, it's definitely not about money, but it's about this ability, about what we can do as photographers, as journalists, this idea about putting information out there for people to learn from and act on. And then I was like, you know what? That's actually pretty interesting. That's something worthwhile spending time on. So this is 1989. So I was in Panama, I was in Berlin when the wall came down. The following year, I was with Juan when Nelson Mandela walked out of prison. I was in Kuwait City when that was liberated during the first Gulf War. I became a prisoner, so I kind of got ups and downs of what it meant to be a photographer and all these different kind of things happening because the world was dramatically changing. And then in 1991, I read an article in the New York Times, a very small article about this place called Yugoslavia. And the conversation that was going on in the world was about this new world order and what was going on, these ideas about nationalism and what was gonna happen now the Soviet Union had collapsed. And so Yugoslavia, people thought, was a country that was either going to do incredibly well or possibly break apart. So off I went to this little part of Yugoslavia called Slovenia, which had declared their independence from the rest of Yugoslavia, and a short war broke out. And then from 1991 through 2000, I spent more than 5 years documenting the different wars of the dissolution of Yugoslavia. So I'll share a piece with you from that.
Don't live under this dream that the West is going to come in and sort this problem out. Don't dream dreams.
Genetically, they're bad people.
The new order in Europe faces its first test. As Yugoslavia's army moves to crush Slovenia's democratic bid for independence, should the rest of Europe stand aside?
It has been reported that the Yugoslav army is surrounding Sarajevo.
Well, Sarajevo is completely surrounded by the Yugoslav army. But they're doing nothing to stop them attacking Sarajevo.
Boris has spent a lot of time in the basement. Even on a quiet day, he rarely ventures beyond the courtyard in front of his apartment house.
They brought him behind the house and they told us to get some things we need for the children.
И когда мы излазили из двери, что мы само чули, когда он крикнул.
And when we were getting out of the courtyard, we heard him scream.
С утра я вратилась кучи. Мне дали дозволу, чтобы я вратилась кучи.
Tomorrow I came back home. They gave me the permission to come back home to get things.
И нашла него мертвого.
And I found him dead.
These photographs here were taken by a photographer who says this yes. It's an atrocity.
No, I will tell you now. First, this lady was shot by the Muslim sniper.
It's not what the photographer says. We also hear that another man running away was shot in the back by these men.
That's not true.
And that somebody
that's not true.
Somebody else was marched off into a nearby building and thrown out of a second floor window.
That's a lie, a pure lie.
No.
The Chetnik forces me to turn off my tape recorder before I go into what was a machine factory. It is a large space, about 100 yards long and 25 wide. About 175 men are evenly divided on each side. They are squatting or sitting cross-legged on wooden slatted boards, only a few inches off the ground. They are in total silence. Nearly all have their eyes averted from us, looking at the floor. I try to communicate, they don't respond.
The woman is the most daring.
She tells us her mother was taken to a detention camp in Chernobyl. And, drawing her index finger quickly across her throat, she explains how her brother was killed in his home in the town of Kozarac. She trembles as she speaks. Her eyes are both frightened and furious. She says all the villages in the area have been burned down.
In this village, people just came in and shot.
A dole je to bilo, dole je to 300 dolara bilo je. Dole su odbili, dole 500 dolara odbili.
One of the Chetniks from the central square has followed us to the Muslim quarter. He breaks into our group and speaks gruffly to the woman, telling her it's not true the villages were leveled. His voice is menacing. She trembles even more. Then she slaps her hand over her mouth and with her other hand puts her finger to her temple in a shooting gesture. She makes it clear the dialogue is over.
There will be no unilateral use of United States force. As we have said before, we are not and we cannot be the world's policeman.
The United States is not prepared to put ground troops into Bosnia in order to resolve or impose a solution onto the conflict.
President Milosevic should have every reason to be clear about the fact that when the West speaks as a unified voice, that he should believe it.
But if this doesn't work, General, what do you think it will do to the people?
Because they it will work.
Srebrenica, that would be a safe area.
Well, what does that mean?
That's surely safe.
Safe area? No?
Okay.
Well, we have early this morning an average of 4,000 per hour, and the total number we had was more than 60,000. That was in the last 36 hours.
Half of my building couldn't sleep, and they were laughing with me, even they didn't know the reason. And now I could laugh, but it's some kind of bitter laugh. And there is no place for laughter here, and there will be no place for a long time.
So it's important to realize that once the war in Slovenia took place, and it's a very short war, that it was pretty obvious to journalists, to pundits, to diplomats, kind of piece by piece, what was going to happen unless there was real intervention from the West. And certainly during the Croatian War, which came to your border, it became even more obvious. And unless there was some intervention, Bosnia was going to occur. So the photographs you saw, starting with the guy with the tiger, have you guys seen that photograph before, anybody? That's a guy named Arkon. He's a Serbian warlord. He led a unit called the Tigers, hence the baby tiger. And the following photographs are some of the first people to be killed in the war in Bosnia, before actually even the official start of the war. And I had managed basically to get Arkon to give me permission to travel with his unit as they went into this town called Bijelina, just over the border from Serbia. And their mission, in his words, was to cleanse the town of Muslim fundamentalists. So the rhetoric was so high, like the war in Bosnia is gonna start, and if it starts, it's gonna be really bad, and so on. So I managed to take these photographs. I lost some, he took some of my film, I hid the rest of the film, I managed to get it out. The photographs were published, magazines around the world. And I thought that this would be enough to kind of push the world or shame the world or show the world, if you don't do anything, this is what's going to happen. Unarmed, middle-aged civilians being executed by well-armed paramilitaries. Photographs were published. There was no reaction. The war started. Almost 4 years of war. More than 100,000 people killed. Millions more became refugees. Led to another war. In Kosovo, conflict in Macedonia, and today, of course, Bosnia is a dysfunctional country. So, again, not that I was naive enough to believe that photographs on their own could start a war, stop a war. But I thought, based on my experience 3 years earlier, and given that in the United States, the same president was in power, there would be some sort of reaction. So as the war started in Bosnia and Sarajevo became encircled, eventually becoming the longest capital city under siege, myself and Chris Morris and Christian Amanpour and many others descended into the city to document what was happening there. And civilians were being shot, children being shot, people waiting for food being bombed, and so on. And after a year or two of doing these photographs and still very little reaction, there came a point, at least for me, when Bosnians would come up to me and said, "Go home. We don't want you here. We don't want anybody to know what's going on here. Stop documenting. You're not helping us. Just let us die alone." Now, based on my earlier experiences and my idea about the power of photography, this idea that trying to go out there and show the world what's happening in order to engage a response, given now, we were completely failing. There was no response. And the people we thought we were trying to help didn't want our help. And at that point, the war was so dangerous that journalists were being targeted, and more journalists were being killed or wounded than any other war since World War II, which was only recently surpassed by Iraq and Syria. But it was very dangerous to work this war. Not obviously as dangerous as it was to be a civilian, but it came to the point where people had to make a decision. Is there any point staying here and documenting? And so some people left. And when it kind of came time for me to decide what I wanted to do, I had to start to really think about what can photography do? What can photojournalism do? It was failing in its initial attempt without question. So what else does it do? So I had to basically just think back to sort of high school history when I studied the Holocaust. When Churchill and Roosevelt were asked, why didn't you bomb the railroad tracks? Why didn't you intervene when you knew that there were camps and so on? And the response was basically, well, we heard, we didn't know, but we didn't really know what was going on. There's no evidence, so we didn't do anything. So already there, that if we all left, if all the journalists left, we would allow people in power to simply say, we didn't know. And then the second thing that comes out of the Holocaust is this idea about never again. Never again will there be another genocide. I've now documented 3 genocides in my career: Rwanda, Bosnia, and Darfur. So that whole thing is out the window, right? But still, people need to be held responsible. So I said, I'm not going to leave. I'm going to continue to build this body of work, this body of evidence, to hold people accountable. And a lot of the work that you saw here has already been used or was used in The Hague to indict and convict war criminals, which is great. But it's not just Milosevic and those people or Arkan that have to be held responsible. It's also, especially in places where the citizenry elects their leadership and was watching the media, which was reporting day in and day out, there has to be an understanding that their leadership from the United States, you know, Bill Clinton, George Bush, Tony Blair, John Major, Helmut Kohl, Mitterrand, all these people are also responsible, and so are the people that put them in power. And the role of journalism plays a very big role in doing that. It doesn't do it by itself, but if it doesn't exist, there's a big gap. And it's really one of the key things that when I realize, and I'm not naive again to think that, oh, photography can save the world. But it is part of this process that we together, audience and provider of information, myself and Joao and others, we're giving you knowledge that you're supposed to then act on and then push other people to act on. It's all part of a process. And so this becomes very important for me and becomes another staple in doing this kind of work. Now, one of the other things that I've realized, having done this now for 30 years, is that these photographs often can take a life of their own. And especially today, where all of you are publishing on Instagram and Snapchat and Facebook, you're putting your work out there, your photographs out there, and you don't know what people will do when they see it, how they will feel, how they will react, what they will learn. So I'm currently finishing up a documentary called Biography of a Photo, where myself and my co-director, Lauren Walsh, we're essentially doing a biography of the photograph from Panama and the photograph that you just saw from Bosnia of Arkan's tigers with the guy with his leg back. And we're basically saying what happened once the photograph left my camera. What did people do when they saw it? And we've discovered all of these different things, from foreign policy to personal, people doing personal things based on the photograph, to art, to culture, to politics, all these different things. And it shows that the power of photography, even in today's world, that the work that we do still has the ability to have impact. It might not be able to stop a genocide, but it can have somebody go, you know what, I never thought of that. Or you know what, I'm gonna do this. Or I'm gonna go donate some money here, or do this or do that. And so the film will be out hopefully by the end of the year, and I'm gonna show you a trailer from the film right now.
En la capital panameña, y mientras rodaban las cámaras de televisión,
you remember those horrible pictures of newly elected Vice President Ford, covered head to toe with blood?
Amongst the most damning evidence against Arkan is this series of pictures taken by an American photographer.
These are civilians, and they are being executed in the most brutal manner by a beast, not by a human being.
Last night, I ordered U.S. military forces to Panama.
This is ethnic cleansing.
También recuerda que es una imagen que se convierte en viral cuando ese término ni siquiera existía, porque estamos hablando de una época pre-internet.
La sangre que él tiene al lado derecho es la sangre de mi hermano, porque a él le dispararon dentro del carro. No quedó nadie detenido por la muerte de él. Yo quiero que esas fotos que se vivió ese día queden en la historia, en el monumento, en vez de ponerle una placa.
The photo has impact that gave Panamanians back our democracy.
So the picture is important as a reminder this can happen again.
Moji roditelja, mog brata, mojih komšija, prijatelja, ne ima više. Ostale su samo uspomene i ova slika. Nadam se da će jednog dana da se bar iko sa ove fotografije osuditi,
optuži. Da bih htio u jednoj reči opisati šta je rat. Moja prva misla bi bila ova fotografija.
And so with that, I welcome Joao to come up here, and we're happy to answer some questions. No questions? There's a lot to take in an hour and a half. You guys did understand what we were saying, right? Sure, no, I understand. I'll start off with the first question. Joao. Is there a question?
Let me ask the first question.
Go ahead.
So, in the internet age, what do you think, what is the purpose of photography? I mean, you talked about a lot about your beliefs that, well, what why are you doing photography, but what do you think the instant photo, the everyone, a photographer in every single situation around the world, what everyone is there, how does it change our photographers, how does it change the photographer's actual purpose right now? Does the internet age actually changed our work in any shape or form? What do you think?
Well, I think, first of all, let's just remember, you know, there are still photographs that have the ability to have impact and go viral, right? So we remember the picture of Alan Kurdi on the beach, right? That photograph in the internet age had direct impact, at the very least, on German migration policy, if not most of the EU. In the United States, a year ago, John Moore took a photograph on the border of a young girl crying that had direct impact on the conversation about immigration to the United States. So this concept of like, oh, because there's, you know, there was 2 trillion photographs taken in 2019. But that doesn't mean that photography and photographs and important photographs can't rise to the top and have impact. And I think more so today than probably ever before, you have the ability to reach people that we never did before. But maybe it can be difficult. The business of photography is definitely different and impacted by the internet. But the idea that imagery can no longer have power because there's too many, I don't agree with that.
Yeah, I don't really have much more to add to that. I mean, at the end of the day, I think we will continue to play a vital role in society, you know. All the cliches apply, you know, the bearing witness, the being a voice of the voiceless. So I think we will continue to have value and continue to play an important role. The industry has changed. Publications are mutating into something new. The internet is going to continue mutating, and with it, so will the industry, but I think it remains important that the images, history is documented, and yeah, there's more outlets now. We've got Instagram, there's so many more ways to tell a story. There's citizen journalists, which never existed when we first started. Often the first powerful images to come out of any incident around the world are from people who are living it firsthand, not journalists that are arriving a day later or a week later once the conflict has really blown. So I think the big question going forward for future generations is how do you survive this transition in terms of making a viable career, finding a way to actually earn a living? As publications try to reinvent themselves, because publications themselves are struggling to stay alive. And a lot of the publications that Ron worked for in the beginning of his career don't exist anymore. And if they do exist, they are a shadow of their former selves. So, I mean, all these things are realities that we have to confront and find a way to move beyond. But at the end of the day, our role remains the same, which is to document history and try force a change. I've always maintained that we don't necessarily change the world, but as photojournalists, if we manage to change one person's mind, we've accomplished something. So I think that will continue to be an important aspect, and I think we should strive to keep doing it.
Hi, I have one more question to you. So after you go home from a conflict zone, how can you manage to be sane? And do you have a routine that you do, or just how do you cope with the situation? Or is it always different?
I think it's different for each individual, you know. When I spoke earlier, I mentioned two friends who took their lives to suicide. The work they did was not the sole reason why they took their own lives. They both guessed themselves, in obviously different circumstances. There was a certain amount of dysfunctional upbringing, but the impact of what they saw certainly had an influence on the decision to take their own lives. For example, Kevin Carter, a very dear friend, he took his life 2 months after winning the Pulitzer Prize. Who the fuck does that, you know? So I think we all deal with this in different ways. We, you know, some of us carry the guilt factor, the part of being a voyeur. I think that has an impact on how you then process what you've witnessed, what you've seen. And I think to a certain extent, we all, as I mentioned earlier again, we are all affected by what we see. I think it's how we process it that matters. You know, in our industry, certainly in my generation, there was a lot of self-medicating. There was a lot of drug abuse. There's a lot of alcohol abuse. Your decompress period, as you would call it. And that was a reality for me too. I was part of that. You know, there was definitely substance abuse and there was definitely a lot of alcohol. And then, you know, at some point in my life, I became a parent. And then I started processing things a little bit different, you know. When I came out of, you know, 2-3 months in Iraq or Afghanistan or wherever, or Georgia, whatever the case, whatever conflict, it's irrelevant. I would get home and I would have to become daddy. I would get home and I would have to change nappies. So there was no time to dwell on the negative thoughts that or the negative images, the negative experiences that have impacted on your psyche, because you automatically had to slip into the role of being a daddy. So I found that process was actually very powerful in letting me adjust to the reality that I was now confronting. Because they're two different realities, you know. When you're in a conflict zone for an extended period of time, that becomes your routine, you know, be it military or be it, you know, mayhem in the streets. And then when you get home to a different reality, you find that it's difficult to communicate to people who have not necessarily lived that experience. You know, I found it always easier to talk amongst our friends about these experiences because we'd lived in similar circumstances. But to talk to a stranger, like a psychiatrist, for example, I, for one, was never able to do it because there was no connection. So having my kids, it kind of took me beyond that inner angst and confusion and pain, because, you know, for me at least, it's when I talk to kids that want to do this kind of work, for me it was always very important to stress, get them to understand the reason for why you're doing this. And important to understand that the people whose lives you're documenting are not props. They're not there for the sake of you making a great image. It's the other way around. You there to document their suffering, to take the reality of war to those who are fortunate enough not to live in a war zone. So, but there will be fallout as a result, because you too are a human being and you will smell the blood, you will feel their pain. And then there's that conflict, internal conflict, where you realize that perhaps even though your intentions of the highest, you know, it's of honorable intentions, at the end of the day, you're intruding on people's most intimate moments. In the sense of a conflict situation, I was always acutely aware, in order for me to have a good day, photographically, of course, somebody is living their worst day of their life. So it was always very important for me to keep that in perspective. But that in turn affects you. It affects you, how you perceive yourself. So getting back to the original quest, it's different for everybody. And it's not only conflict. Any journalist who exposes himself to anything traumatic, there will be a certain amount of fallout. And we will deal with it differently. So I had my drugging stage. I had my stage of alcohol, and that's when my friends were killing themselves and that kind of stuff. And then I had my family period where the readjustment was easier because I wasn't allowed to dwell in my self-pity because I had to become a father immediately coming out of the war zone. The two-year-old kid or the four-year-old kid, they don't care if you've just been under fire for a month. Or they don't care if you've just seen, you know, a dozen people mangled from a car bomb. They need you present as a father, as a human being. So that helped, if that makes any sense. But I think we all struggle with what we see. And to this day, I continue to, I mean, I still think about the things that I could have done, should have done, and didn't do. But that's just part of being human being. And if you don't answer those questions, then there's something honestly wrong with you. Because as I said, these are real lives that are being destroyed in front of you. They're not props.
Do you feel any difference between the respect of the photojournalist or the photojournalist? So what do you feel, how was it 10 years ago, 20 years ago, or now, to be a photojournalist, I mean, in the society? So what do you feel? How do you have any respect from the public?
From the public that we live in?
Mm-hmm.
That's a good question. I'm not sure how much respect there's been throughout my career. Certainly, at least in the United States, the respect of journalism is pretty low. I think one thing, though, that kind of in a different, not exactly the answer to your question, but what has changed in terms of the relationship with people is that we used to be, especially for armed combatants and so on, different groups, we would be their only ability to tell their story. So we go into places and we would be accepted, we would be protected because they thought we would tell their story. And then because of the digital age where they were able to read and watch and look at everything that people were doing, that quickly changed and the journalists became then a target. And the second part of that is when you take it to the extreme, using, let's say, ISIS as an example, where they have no need whatsoever for journalists because they have their own media team, right? So our ability now to document and explain and explore all sides is much more limited in what we can do. So the role of the journalist, photographer, TV, etc., has dramatically changed, and it's much more difficult to work. And that doesn't totally reference your question, but I think it's a pretty key change in what's gone on, certainly in the amount of time that Joao and I have been working.
Hi. Kind of related question. How would you say your time is divided between doing photojournalism proper and events such as this right now? And also how your income is just percentage wise, not meant to pick your pockets, but
that's good because there's nothing in them to pick. it's probably very different because Joao and I are doing different things. So I'm co-directing a film. I'm running the Seven Academy, where we're providing free workshops for, and I hope all of you from Hungary are available to apply for the next masterclass from the Seven Academy. It's a 9-month free program studying in the Balkans. So I'm running those kind of programs as well as continuing, like I was photographing the US presidential campaign last week. So it's a constant, for me, a constant juggle, and finances are part of it. figuring out ways that will bring in income and figuring out ways that I'll be able to do the work that I want to do. I mean, Joao has a very different life, and I'll let him explain his.
As Ron says, it's different for everybody, you know. As freelancers, you juggle what you can, and Ron has been a freelancer most of his life. You know, he's had a contract with magazines, but essentially you're still, you know, a freelancer. You know, in my case, in terms of my time, when I was working full-time, I'd spend, on average, 7 months of the year traveling. Not in one chunk. It'd be 2 months here, then home, then 2 months there. And then, of course, when I was home, the New York Times would leave me alone. I've been with the New York Times since 96. So it's been a long career, first as a freelancer, then as contract, and then eventually as staff. So I've always had a regular income to a certain extent. And before I was New York Times, I was contract with Associated Press. So I've always been in a fortunate position that I've always had some sort of retainer or income, steady income, not having to constantly worry about finding an assignment. And I was very fortunate to be in that position. Now, of course, it's a little bit different. I do this kind of stuff maybe 3 times a year, this, you know, judging and public speaking kind of stuff. We don't get paid for doing any of this. This is, you know, this. We do it because it's our love for the industry and our love for photography and, you know, making sure there's a next generation. So if we somehow inspire, that's good. And by inspiring, also make sure people know what they're getting themselves into. So it's part inspiration, part education. But I'm still employed. I still get on a plane once a month and I go shoot whatever's required for me to shoot. For example, earlier this month, I was in Zanzibar, and before that, I was in a small little place called Lesotho. So, yeah, it's doable, but it's become way more difficult. Financially, that is.
I just also want to just sort of reference what I just mentioned. So, Gary Knight, myself, started the Seven Foundation. And Gary has led a cause for education called the Seven Academy. If you go to vii.academy, you can learn about all the programming. And in May, we're going to announce the next series of master classes for the Balkans, which includes free tuition for photographers from Hungary. This is our first class is finishing in May. We only have one student from Budapest, but I encourage you all to apply. It's a combination of in-class experience will be taking place most likely in Sarajevo, Zagreb, and Belgrade. And then there's 100 hours over a course of 9 months online training with different teachers. So and feel free to email me if you have more questions about that.
Oh, hello. My question is, what's your strategy to survive those conflict zone assignments? How do you feel that you are in such a danger that you have to take a step back?
Are you talking about physically surviving? I mean, I think for sure if anybody is interested in working in war zones or anywhere around war zones, including refugee camps or so on, the first thing you absolutely have to do is take what's known as a hostile environment training course. These are courses that teach you how to think, how to prepare, how to deal with medical trauma. There are places like the Rory Peck organization that will give you links to scholarships that are available. There's a lot of free places in different classes. In fact, if I met you on a battlefield, my first question to you would be, had you taken this course? If you didn't take the course, I would walk away from you as fast as possible. In fact, most publications now are asking before they give an assignment, have you taken this course? So I highly recommend if you are interested in doing that kind of work, you really should take the course.
It's a lifesaver, without question. I actually didn't take it because it didn't exist. I took it probably 6 or 7 years into my career, and I had already known all the stupid mistakes I had made and luckily survived. I had known all of them, I had known some of them, and then when I took the course, I realized how even more lucky I was from all the stupid things that I did. So I've even taken refresher courses. It's incredibly valuable. Thank you very much.